You know, if I move, this thing is gonna... Okay, so it's only up here. All right. Ready. Hi, how are you? Where's your husband?
Good afternoon, Mrs. Nixon.
Good afternoon, Cindy. How are you?
Great. Thank you for being here today. We're so honored to have this interview today, and I'm so honored to host it with you, especially here at the Richard Nixon Presidential Library, a very fitting place to have this conversation with you today. And especially because it's your birthday.
Yes.
So I want to wish a very, very happy birthday today.
Thank you.
And we look forward to getting to know you.
Thank you so much for being here, Cindy. And I understand that you have been volunteering here since you were 12. 17
Not
years.
Not quite, but.
17 years, so thank you so much. And thank you so much for all of you being here today. It's really great to see all of you. And if I were not mic'd as being Pat Nixon and portraying Pat Nixon, I would want to shake all of your hands and I want to find out where you're from and give you a big hug. So just consider that.
So we're just going to have a conversation today and get to know you better.
Thank you. Thank you.
So you were born on March 16th, 1912, but your father celebrated your birthday on March 17th, which of course is St. Patrick's Day, and called you his Saint Patrick's babe in the morning.
Right.
Now, he called you babe for several years, but your name was really Thelma Catherine Ryan before you became known as Pat Ryan. So could you share with us your early years as babe?
So how many of you in this room started off with a name, but then it became a nickname? Anybody? I see a few of you. So it's really a lot. I was actually born in Ely, Nevada. Anybody been to Ely? Oh my golly, wow. This is a good start. So I was actually born in Ely, Nevada, very close to midnight on March 16th, 1912. Mm-hmm. So how many of you can quickly figure out the math? As if I would be here today, from 1912 to 2023, 111. Good for you, that was quick. So I was born there in a copper miner's shack with no indoor plumbing and no indoor electricity. How many of you have experienced that? I see a couple of, you're not even old enough for that. Oh my golly, this is amazing. I should have people stand up. So I was born very close to midnight, and I joined my two brothers, Tom and Will. They were both older than I was. And as I said, my dad, whose name was Will, was a copper miner, and my mother's name was Kate. And when I was born, as Cindy said, my dad wanted to name me his St. Patrick's babe, babe in the morning. How many of you have had a really strong-willed mother? My mother, whose name was Kate, as I mentioned, she wanted to name me Thelma. So guess who ruled out? My mom. So my mom called me Thelma, my dad called me Babe, and my classmates called me Buddy, and then ultimately I changed my name to Pat in honor of my dad, but I'll get to that. Anyway, so my dad, when I was 2 years old, he became really tired of copper mining. Anybody born in a copper miner's shack with indoor, oh my golly, you're amazing. This is so exciting. I feel like I'm home. So he got really tired of it and he wanted to do something else. And he wanted to try his hand at farming. So he and my mom and my two brothers and I, when I was 2 years old, we actually came to Southern California to Cerritos, which is about 20 minutes from here. It's an absolutely wonderful place. There was a house on the property, it was farm, and my dad saw it and he said, this is it. And so with little money, they were able to buy the house that sits on the farm. My dad absolutely loved it. He loved farming, and according to my dad, he grew the biggest cabbages in Cerritos, if not the entire world. So people would come from all over. He grew fruits and vegetables, and he put them on a truck. So it was called truck farming. And people, as I said, they came from all over to buy his fruits and vegetables. And as I got older, my dad actually gave me some land and I could plant my own fruits and vegetables. How many of you in here grew up on a farm? Wow, I see three people. No indoor farming, no electricity, born on a farm. You could come up and do this. Yes, awesome. So he absolutely loved farming. My mom worked really, we worked hard. We didn't take ourselves that seriously, so we really enjoyed. We took our jobs seriously. So if you ever worked on a farm and really grown things, you know that it just doesn't happen overnight. It takes a lot, but it was really, really fun. So you asked me about St. Patrick's Babe in the Morning, Babe, Thelma, and then ultimately Pat, and I'll tell you about how Pat came along.
Thank you. Now, it was so sad because you lost both your parents by the time you were 17 years old. What was life like for you? You and your two brothers. It must have been so difficult.
You know, it really was. When I was 13 years old, I was, how many of you know about Excelsior High School? Oh my golly, this is like, I'm totally home. This is amazing. So when I was 13 years old at Excelsior High School, my mother, who'd been really a very strong woman, in fact, she loved to bake, and so every afternoon she baked cinnamon rolls for us when we got home from school, and almost all the way, which is 2 miles from our house, walking, we could actually smell those cinnamon rolls. She was wonderful, but you know, when I was 13, she became weaker and weaker to the point where she could hardly get out of bed, and we thought, what in the world is going on? So we said, Mom, you got to go to the doctor. But you know how moms are. It's like, oh, well, I'll feel better tomorrow. And they delayed it and delayed it. So by the time she got to the doctors, she was diagnosed with Bright's disease, which is a kidney condition, and she had cancer. So she took a lot of medicine, and the medicine didn't work. And so when she was 13, she died. And I think the saddest thing for me, Cindy, was when Mother's Day was celebrated at Excelsior High School, I didn't have a mom. But one of the teachers were really nice enough to come with me and to be my mom for the day. So we all pitched in. I took over the chores in the kitchen. My two brothers helped my dad in the farm. And we actually made it work. But then when I was a senior at Excelsior High School, my dad, as I told you, his name is Will, he started coughing, and he didn't stop coughing. And we said, Dad, you have to go to the doctor. But you know how dads are. Oh, they're even more stubborn than moms. Oh, well, you know, I'll go tomorrow. You know how this will go away. Well, it didn't go away. And by the time he actually went to the doctor, he was diagnosed with full-blown tuberculosis. And the doctors gave him a lot of tonics. They told me that I had to wash and sterilize all of his utensils, all the bed sheets, everything. So that was pretty much a daily chore that I did too. And when I was 17, he passed away. It was really tough. The three of us were orphans when we were 17 years old. We all wanted to go to college. We all loved school. And my brother Tom was a big strapping guy. He was a football player at Excelsior High School, and he applied for a scholarship to that best university in the entire world, University of Southern California. Go Trojans. How many of you graduated from USC or went to USC? All right, stand up. So he got a scholarship to USC, to University of Southern California, and I actually did odd jobs that qualified me to go to Fullerton Junior College. And then my other brother was very interested in lighting, so he went to work for one of the studios, Universal Studio, in the lighting department. We made it work. We really did. We made it work. And as I said, I can't repeat this too often, we actually took our job seriously, but really we just didn't take ourselves that seriously. So we actually enjoyed being together.
Well, that was definitely a tough time.
It was.
And we know that you attended USC, and yes, I'm a USC fan too, so. And you got your degree in education, but before you tell me about why you decided to be a teacher, I just wanted to make a comment about your name, Thelma Catherine Ryan, because it was actually when you enrolled at Whittier or Fullerton Junior College that you changed your name from Thelma Catherine to Ryan and enrolled as Pat Ryan.
You are really good. Cindy, that's a lot.
I'll have to get to know you well today. But so you attended USC, you got your degree in education. What made you decide to want to be a teacher?
You know, I think you're all too young here, but there was a department store called Bullock's Wilshire. Oh, I see heads nodding. I had said it. So I did odd jobs to actually pay for my tuition to go to Fullerton Junior College. And one of the jobs I had was in sales at Bullock's Wilshire. And back in the day, the women came in and they just sat, very lovely, and then I would go back and select clothes for them. And it was really fun because some of the actresses at the time, like Marlene Dietrich and I think Marilyn Monroe came in one time. It was really exciting. And so, but you know, the job, I wanted to major in merchandising because I really liked it. But then I realized I was on my feet all day long and we didn't have any vacation. So I loved my teachers. I loved learning so much. And also I have to tell you that when I was in school, because my parents had both passed away and my teachers knew it, sometimes I would be dozing off in class. Not often, but sometimes I would be dozing off in class. But my teachers were so supportive and they were so encouraging. And so I actually changed my major from merchandising to teaching and then was really happy about that. You know, teachers get 3 months off. We deserve it too. How many of you in here have taught or teachers? Oh my golly. We're going from Ely, Nevada to the farm to Fullerton, yes. Okay, so you know how hard you work. It's really, and you are the role model for many of your class, of your students. So thank you for all your hard work. I love teaching, so.
Well, you enjoy drama and actually had a small part in a movie and a couple of leads in your high school plays. And Richard Nixon also enjoyed drama. I believe that you and President Nixon met while auditioning for a community play in Whittier called The Dark Tower. Could you tell us about that first meeting with Richard Nixon?
Well, when I was teaching at Whittier High School, and maybe some of the places where you've taught school, the principal's very involved in the community. So one day, and thank you for telling me that saying that I had changed my name in honor of my father when he passed away. I changed my name from Thelma to Babe to Buddy to to Pat in honor of my dad. So when the principal came in, and I was hired at Whittier High School to teach, remember shorthand, filing, yes, typing on a typewriter. So I was hired to teach those things. And the principal came in and he said, you know, Pat, I saw from your resume that you were really active in theater in high school and in college. So there is a community theater. How many of you have been involved in theater? Oh my golly, we've got 5 people involved in theater. This is a very active group. This is probably one of the most active groups I've been with. So he said, why don't you go audition? Because they are exactly what you said, Cindy. They are doing a play called The Dark Tower, which was a murder mystery, and it was awesome. So I auditioned for the part, and I got the part. It was really exciting. And then through the door comes a very nice-looking man, and he introduced himself, and he said, you know, my name is Richard Nixon, and I've just graduated from Duke Law School, and I came out to practice law in Whittier. And his boss suggested to him that he get involved in theater. So that's how we met. And he was talking about, you know, when we had some downtime, because you know how theater is. You actually do your rehearsal or whatever, and then you sit and wait for the director, all this kind of stuff. So he was telling me about wanting to go far away places and make a difference in his community and his country. I loved listening to him. He was really, really a man who had a purpose. So I found him very interesting.
Now, you were 28 years old.
I was 28 years old.
When you and Richard Nixon got married, and you got married on June 21st, 1940, in the Mission Inn at Riverside. Tell us about your wedding day. Did you have a large wedding party, like most wedding parties actually do today?
I want to take you back to the theater that night. So we were rehearsing. We both got the parts. So we're leaving. Now imagine a room like this, because it was in a church where we had the stage was set, and that's where we were doing our performing. So I'm walking out. This, mind you, this is the first night that I've met him. He opens the door for me, and he looks me straight in the eye, and he says, "You may not know this, but someday I'm going to marry you." Okay, question for the group. Has this ever happened to anybody in this room? Okay, wow, first time ever I've seen this. So I thought he was insane. I thought he was totally crazy. And I had two roommates, and I went back that night, and I said, "You won't believe this. This attorney who's been cast in this play just said, you know, you may not know this, but I'm going to marry you someday." And we all thought it's crazy. And I wasn't ready to get married. I was not ready to get married at all. But can you believe this? That he would write me letters and call me his dearest heart, his vagabond gypsy. And he would drive me from my house to my dates. Can you imagine? He would pick me up. He said, "So what are you doing Tuesday night?" "Well, I have a date with Fred." He said, "Well, I'll drive you." So he would drive me. Talk about getting a little bit, whoa. But, you know, he was kind. I didn't have a car. He was really, really kind. And I thought, well, you know, there's no harm in that. But you know what? I really found myself falling in love with him. He was so kind and so supportive. And he was so much fun to be with. And I thought, yes. So we did. We got married in June, and we had a really small wedding because the war was in 1940, because the war was still going on, and so we had a very, very small wedding, and his side of the family was quite large, and my side was not so small either. So what we did was we had a small wedding, which was really nice with just the family, and then we actually splurged on a two-week trip to Mexico. Anybody been to Mexico? I see many people in the room have been to Mexico. And what we did was we wanted to splurge for dinner. So we saved all of our money for a two-week honeymoon for dinners driving down the Pan American Highway. Anybody been on the Pan American Highway? Yes. Okay, so what we did was we went to the store and we bought a lot of canned food. So we bought canned fruit, canned vegetables, canned meats, canned tuna, cans, whatever you find in cans. And we put those all together in the trunk of our car. Guess what? Rascals that they were. Our friends were able to get into the back of our car. They took off all of the labels of the cans in the back of the car. So, exactly. So when we opened a can for breakfast, it might have been tuna. And when we opened a can for lunch, but you know what? It was, we didn't care it was food, for heaven's sakes. And then we actually splurged in dinner, and we had a really great time. We took 2 weeks, and it was just absolutely wonderful. And then when we came back, you know, he had to go back to practicing law, and I went back to teaching. So it was good that we took those 2 weeks off. It was fun. Small wedding.
Small wedding.
Small wedding.
Now, you were known as President Nixon's goodwill ambassador. And I recall seeing a photo of you wearing a bright blue outfit and wearing a matching turban, actually, around your head. And I believe that was your trip to Liberia.
Yes.
So, tell us, you had these long trips. How did you plan for these long trips? And sometimes they were 2 months long. Who did your gorgeous hair? And did you have ladies in waiting, an entourage, to help you out?
So you're absolutely right. Cindy, you've done a lot of work on this interview. Thank you very much. So yes, I went to the inauguration of the women president of Liberia, and you mentioned that I traveled sometimes for 2 months and 45,000 miles, sometimes to 11 countries, and a different outfit for every time. So how I packed was I actually only brought polyester clothes. Clothes that didn't have to, remember, anybody wear polyester? Hello. so So yes, polyester clothes, because they pack beautifully, they don't wrinkle. I had one woman come with me who was instrumental. She did my hair because sometimes it was really very, very humid. Other times it was cold, and she was really great. And then I had another woman who was actually took care of what we call correspondence. Those were the only two people who actually traveled all these large distances with me. But going to those countries was really incredible. And they sent me because in some of these countries, in Liberia and Ghana and the Ivory Coast and through Asia, the Philippines, Thailand, they had never really had a diplomat from the United States come. And so it was great because I got to talk to the people about what their concerns were and also to visit the orphanages, visit the hospitals, visit the schools, which was part of my love, visit their farms, see what they were growing, since I had such a love for farming as well.
I also recall seeing a picture of you when you were in the Philippines. You were wearing this gorgeous dress made out of this Filipino fabric, which is what they call a terno.
Mm-hmm.
And I've worn one of those ones because I was born there. So I'm very glad you got to go there, but it's very hot and humid. You were correct. Now, the first Sunday after the inauguration in 1969, the Reverend Billy Graham held a church service in the East Room.
In fact,
we are in that gorgeous replica of that East Room today.
Mm-hmm.
And many ministers of faith conducted services of different faiths in the East Room. But you and President Nixon hosted events in the East Room called Evenings in the White House,
mm-hmm.
and you entertained many of those entertainers in the East Room. What are a few of your more memorable events that occurred here in the East Room?
Well, we'll go back, and I don't think anybody is probably old enough to remember this, but Billy Graham, I'm sure you all heard of, and he actually gave the Sunday services to here, along with Norman Vincent Peale, who was such a champion of positive thinking. So we did. We had many, many church services here. And then I don't know whether anybody's old enough to remember Duke Ellington, Count Basie. Yes. Okay, the Carpenters, Bluegrass, and then Light Opera, the Carousel, The King and I, Sound of Music. So we had, this room was just alive with music and different celebrations. I want to go back, if you don't mind, to the dress that I wore in the Philippines.
Mm-hmm.
I splurged on one dress, and that was the dress that I wore in the Philippines. It was organza, and I was so thrilled to have something that wasn't polyester. So here I am getting ready, and it's very, very hot. I'm getting ready, and I'm really excited about this beautiful fabric that you have in the Philippines. I'm walking down the hall to an absolutely beautiful, beautiful dinner, and I realize that at the bottom of the skirt that my hem caught on a nail or something. My skirt started, with every step I took, my dress started unraveling all the way down the hall, and I was just praying, "Dear Lord, please, help me get to the ballroom before I'm actually naked."
Well, thank you for sharing that story with us today.
So thank you, thank you, thank you. I made it into the ballroom. It is pretty much right up to here as I have now. And I think that that was the name of that day, the statue was born, because I couldn't move. I wouldn't dare move because every time I took a step, it was going to, you know, unravel more. So when I did sit down, I was able to find out where this knotty place was and then take it off and then walk back before the whole thing unraveled. But the fabric was so beautiful, I just couldn't pass it up. So the statue was born.
Well, thank you for sharing that story. That's one that others haven't heard before. But on March 3rd, 1973, Sammy Davis Jr. actually performed an event here in the East Room as one of those events, an evening in the White House. And he suggested to you and President Nixon that you do an event to honor the Vietnam POWs that had just come home on February 12, 1973. Mm-hmm. The first 40 of those POWs came on that flight, left Hanoi, and then landed at Clark Air Force Base in the Philippines and came to the U.S. And Everett Alvarez,
yes,
who was the longest held POW in Vietnam,
for 8 years,
of course, on our foundation board today. Mm-hmm. And he was on that flight, that very first flight. But you also suggested that a White House dinner be given to honor them in their return. And you know, I think that those 591 men from Vietnam who came back, they were such an extraordinarily mm-hmm. courageous group. Could you tell us about that emotional evening?
Well, you certainly captured it very, very well. I'd like to ask all the people who have served in the military to stand up. Please stand up today. It's so extraordinary, and exactly what you said, am I still wired? So Sammy Davis Jr. suggested this, and then indeed, we actually started the preparations for honoring the prisoners of war who had come back from Vietnam. The evening, it was lightly raining, just drizzling, and so we put up tents all over the back lawn of the White House. And it was so extraordinary. We had, can you imagine? We had John Wayne, Bob Hope, Sammy Davis Jr., Irving Berlin, and a star-studded evening. I think, aside from the entertainment that night, the 591 prisoners of war who came back with their spouses or their girlfriends, we actually had a corsage for all of them. So the room was actually 1,300 people. It was just incredible, absolutely incredible. And I just, because my husband had ended the war in Vietnam with honor and peace and brought them home, it was even more, just more spectacular. Some of the prisoners of war who had been tapping on the wall with their code had not realized until that night, when they heard somebody talking about their wife or their son out loud, they realized that they had been right next door to that person. So they actually met, if you would, the two captives. It was just incredible. One of the men who came back had fashioned a flag, a tiny flag, out of bits of the sheet and a Red Cross string. And so he had made a flag that he came. It was just, I'm going to cry. It was just so incredible. So he came out waving his flag. And so my husband and I actually stayed there until 11 o'clock. And at 11 o'clock, we decided that we'd leave and let them, you know, talk among themselves. They didn't go home until 4 o'clock in the morning. They had such a great time. And so we went upstairs, and we were standing on the balcony looking over at this incredible event. And I remember hearing Irving Berlin, who is a very famous songwriter. He was actually playing God Bless America. And it was absolutely riveting. It really was. It was so special and unforgettable. And I can't say enough good things about it. And to the military who have given their lives so that we can be free and do our own thinking is just such a, you can hardly wrap your head around it. It's just really, really, really special.
Must have been so different because before that, you were the very first president's wife to tour the Republic of China in 1972. So that must have been quite a difference from going to this trip to China and then coming, having these POWs to come home. But could you tell us about your trip to China and how you got the pandas to our National Zoo? Because I really want to know, because when we lived in Washington, D.C., I used to take our son in his stroller and go to the National Zoo because it was free and go see the pandas. So tell us how we got the pandas here to our zoo.
Okay, so starting at the beginning, no foreigners had been to China since 1929, if you can figure that out. And so my husband decided, or was thinking, China had 800 million people. So if China joined forces with Russia, they would be a huge force to contend with, a huge force. And so Secretary of State Kissinger actually started in contact with Chou Enlai, who was the Prime Minister of China, for quite a long time, going back and forth, and you know how that goes, back and forth. Maybe you can come, maybe you can't. Well, we'll see. Well, what's the date? Well, you know, pull the rug, extend the rug, whatever. And finally, we got the green light to go. And of course, as women, what do we think? We think, what are we going to wear? You know, I packed all polyester, but I thought, you know, this is going to be an incredible trip. And how many of you have been to China? Oh my golly, half the room. Good for you. So you know what it's like. So actually, I didn't have a polyester coat. I got a red coat. And red, evidently, in Chinese, I hope I get this right, means good luck. So I got a red coat, and it was really, really cold. So I got a red coat with a collar and a hat and long gloves and boots. When we landed in China, and my husband walked down the ramp and extended his hand to Chou Enlai, it was actually the handshake that changed the world. And I remember looking out and thinking I'd landed on the moon. It was so vast that I couldn't even think. This is just huge, absolutely enormous. Chou Enlai was very, very, very entertaining, for want of a better word. He talked through an interpreter. We think perhaps he could speak English. But when you know when you speak through an interpreter, you have a little more time to think about what your remarks are going to be. Anyway, because I would say things sometimes and he would nod his head before his interpreter actually translated. The rascal. So anyway, my husband was in meetings all day long about diplomacy. How are we going to open the door? How are we going to stay in touch? But I wanted to visit the schools. And I wanted to see acupuncture. How many of you have ever seen acupuncture? Oh my God, this room is just full of everything that I'm saying. You can get up here and actually talk with me. So I went to an open heart surgery, and the wonderful interpreter said to me, Mrs. Nixon, please do not throw up, and please do not pass out. So I'd never seen open heart surgery, and in China there weren't any laws. I didn't have to put on any gloves or a hazmat or anything. I was just there watching this incredible surgery. I wanted to visit the schools, and the children were adorable. They had their little jackets on, and they'd learned two songs in English. One was Row, Row, Row Your Boat, and the other one was You Are My Sunshine. So they were absolutely adorable. I wanted to take them home. And then they said, well, Mrs. Nixon, what would you like to do? And there we go, to the zoo. And in the zoo, how many of you have seen pandas? Actually, wow, there we go again. So I actually saw these pandas, and they were so, you know how adorable they are. You just want to hug them. They're so cute. Mm. So when I got back in the evening, and we were sitting, and Premier Chou Enlai was nice enough. How did you spend your day? I told him about acupuncture. I told him about the school. And I actually visited a hospital as well. But I said, you know, the highlight of the day, I have to tell you, was seeing the pandas in the zoo. So without the interpreter, all the way going, would you like some? Pointing to the cigarettes on the desk, which had two pandas on them. And I thought, he said, would you like some? And I said, well, actually, I'd like the real pandas in the zoo. Oh, he says, we'll get you some, through the interpreter. And I thought, how in the world are you going to get those two pandas from your zoo over to our zoo? And he said, you don't worry, I'll get them. So saying to him, thank you, thank you, thank you, but then I thought, I better ask him what he'd like from us. So I said, with all due respect and thank you very much, we will look forward to those pandas. By the way, Ling Ling and Zing Zing, who lived to be 28 years old, and had special meals and everything. Anyway, he said, I would like two oxen. Have you ever seen oxen? They're like the opposite of a panda. They are shaggy. They are not endearing. They are like, stay away. They smell. I mean, pardon me for saying that if you're an oxen, but they are just not the kind of thing that I thought he was going to say. But we sent Milton and Matilda to China, and they lived out their years too. So in spite of the fact that it was a very serious trip, mm-hmm. you know, lots of policy and everything, that evening I think really was extremely memorable because he delighted in the fact that I loved not the cigarettes, but the pandas. And then we talked about the oxen, and I thought to myself when we went back to the room, I said, Dick, how in the world could you love an oxen? You know, each to his own, so that's it.
Now, when we got the pandas, it was a gift, actually, from
yes.
China. But today, countries have to rent pandas.
Really?
So we were very fortunate that Chuan Lai gave us those pandas as a gift.
Yes.
Due to you, we got those pandas.
Well, they were just, you know, as you mentioned, you know, if you've seen pandas, and, you know, I didn't know that much about pandas, but and I know you know a lot about them, but when the pandas are born, they are like they're the size of your hand, if not even smaller. They're teeny. And I thought, that's a baby panda? You know, because they're big, you would think that they would have a larger but they're very, very teeny. And those pandas eat a lot. I mean, they spend the day, like, eating a lot.
Now, I have sort of a personal question for you. You were on the campaign trail, of course, with Richard Nixon when he ran for Congress, when he ran for the Senate, as vice president, and as president. Did you have a close friend with whom you could just be Pat Nixon?
Thanks a million for that question. I did. As I mentioned, when I was hired at Whittier High School, a woman named Helene graduated from UCLA. And she actually was, and Pat, I graduated from USC, as you know. So when Helene and I were hired to teach at Whittier High School, we became the best lifetime, longtime friends. I never had a sister, and Pat had a stepsister, but she didn't see her that often. So we actually grew to be the best friends. And our husbands, Jack and Helene, and Pat and my husband Dick and I, became actually the foursome. We spent tons and tons of time together, and we visited each other, we supported each other, we went out with each other, we went out to dinner. It was during the war, so we had rations. We ate Chinese food on the floor of our tiny, meager apartments. And with Helene, she really became my best friend. So we could talk about absolutely everything. And back in the day, it was prohibitive, the expense, when she went actually back to the White House. It was so expensive to phone. And so we actually wrote letters back and forth together. Pat, I actually received between 500 and 1,000 letters a week. And I tried to answer as many of those as I could because I like to keep my finger on the pulse of what was going on and hearing from people. Every person wanting to know, how can I get involved in politics? How do you manage being gone with your two beautiful daughters, Tricia and Julie? What is your dog? We had a dog, Irish Setter. I have to tell you one quick story. The Irish Setter, that you know, they're water dogs. Anybody had an Irish Setter here? Okay, they're water dogs, and King Timahoe was supposed to stay in the White House, inside, but he was a rascal, and he could get out, and so when the tour buses came along, Timahoe would be swimming in the White House fountains, and he was really, really naughty. Then he'd come back, and he'd shake all off, and he'd jump on the furniture, and he was really naughty, but some people were asking me, so what do you feed your dog? Where do you get your clothes? How do you balance between being a mother, First Lady of the country, and then doing your travels? It was really great, and I wanted so badly to answer those letters so that I could learn what people were really thinking.
Thank you very much for that. Today, we're actually in this amazing, beautiful Richard Nixon Presidential Library and Museum. Now, there are a host of docents who volunteer at this library, and they volunteer and they tell the story of President Nixon's legacy. These docents actually make this library shine.
Mm-hmm.
And without them, I'm not sure what the library would be doing, but they are quite amazing. And you entertained hundreds of volunteers at the White House. You are also known for your focus on volunteerism. Why is volunteerism so close to your heart?
Well, how many of you in this room are volunteers? Stand up. Look at this. I would stand up again and salute you and applaud, but every time I stand up, my wire disconnects. So, yes, if you 17 years of volunteering, I know, thank you so much for all your volunteer work. I've always volunteered. I volunteer with the Girl Scouts. They're really near and dear to my heart. I volunteered in hospitals with the Red Cross. So for me to volunteer, and I realize that volunteers, you don't have to have a college education to be a volunteer. You have to go through training, and you have to learn what you're going to do. But you actually don't have to have a college education. And if we took all of the volunteers out of the Nixon Library, I doubt it would function. I truly call the volunteers the backbone of the country. And I actually promoted it. So I went all around the United States, actually going to the hospitals and the churches and the schools, actually encouraging people to get involved in volunteer work. It's been said that a volunteer receives much more than they can give, because you see the lights on people's faces when you've made such a difference in their lives. Where would the hospitals be without the volunteers? Where would the churches? Where would the schools? Where would our museums, our libraries, the Nixon Library, be without the volunteers? So it's so near and dear to my heart. And you volunteered here for 17 years. So take that out. Take Darlene out. Take all of you out, you know, who have been incredible volunteers. And I doubt, as you said so wisely, I don't think it would survive. You'd have to close your doors. So thank you so much. I would love to actually shake all of your hands and bring you up here.
Wait, they do make the library shine.
Yes, you do. Sure. And it's a lot of work. But you know, in volunteer working, there's never the same day. There's never the same day. You get to meet people from all over. So you really know what the general public is thinking and what they're talking about and what their interests are. So it's a good way, too, to actually find out what's going on. Yeah.
I wanted to let you know that I received a letter from a gentleman yesterday, and he had heard that we were going to be doing this interview, this conversation, and it was such an amazing story. He said that he had gone to Washington, D.C. in 1972 on a school trip, and they were an eighth-grade class from Whittier. And you heard that they were coming to Washington, D.C., and you invited them to come to the White House. So they actually came, and you hosted them at the White House, this eighth-grade class from Whittier, all the way to Washington, D.C., gets to be hosted by Pat Nixon.
Oh, my gosh, what a wonderful letter.
It was just a wonderful letter.
That's awesome. I have to tell you about one White House tour. This little boy comes through, and I'm saying, you know, this is the White House, and we actually live here. And he was 8 years old. He said, no, you don't. This really threw me. I thought I'd heard everything. He said, no, you don't live here, because there's no washing machine. I don't see any washing machine around. So basically what I did was I took him to the family quarters, and I showed him where our washing machine was, just to tell him that we actually did live here. But you know, when you never know when you greet people what they're gonna say. And that one really did throw me, because he was in earnest. He said, no, you can't possibly live here. There's no washing machine. And I thought, I'm going to take him and show him. And he will be the one who will say, you know, they actually do live in the White House, because I got to see where their washing machine is.
That is a great story, a great story. And I want to touch on something that is probably a little difficult, Now, President Nixon was known for his foreign policy and, of course, his domestic policies. He accomplished 10 domestic policies here for our country, which made such a positive impact on our country. And then this cloud of Watergate came over it. And for some reason, some of those achievements and accomplishments just kind of got passed over during Watergate time. What specific ways did you survive Watergate?
Well, I mentioned my best friend, Helene. And Helene was Helene and Jack, their last name was Drown, just like sinking in the ocean. And they lived here in Southern California. They were of incredible support. My family, my two daughters, Tricia and Julie, my husband was incredible through that time. It was a really rough time. You know, my husband didn't authorize that break-in. So when he found out about it, what he did was he tried to protect the people who had done that. And instead of dragging this country through a trial, he said to me one night, Pat, you know what? It's in the best interest of that country that I need to resign. Because if I don't resign, I'm going to be impeached, and we're going to have to drag this wonderful country that I love and serve so much through this whole thing. So we talked about it, and we were all in accord, yes, that he should resign. Was it easy? How many of you have been through a really dramatic thing in your life where you had to make a decision that really cost you what you love to do in all earnest? So the fact is that I really completely believed in the American people. I had met so many of them. I'd been through 11 campaigns, and I had met so many of them and heard their stories and hugged them, been invited to their homes. When we were doing campaigns through the Senate and the Congress back in the day, people actually invited us into their homes. I usually gained 20 pounds every campaign. have this cake, you know, stay. It was absolutely, I really believed in the incredible, incredible love and support of the American people. And I had to believe that in my heart, this was a great country, an absolutely fantastic country. And having traveled so much around the world and seeing other countries and the way that people lived, our freedom in this country, we can never take it for granted. And the military in this room that have served so well, and the volunteers and all of you who have made this country so great, that's what I held on to. Was the goodness of the American people. Was it easy? Absolutely. I know I can tell you about my best friend, Helene, that she came back and was tremendous support. And when Helene got back to California, she wrote me and she said, you know, Pat, when I got in the back of the car and headed out to the plane, I sat in the back of the car and cried. It was very, very sad. The fact is that we just decided we were going to get through this, and we were going to still love and trust, as always, the American people. So we did. Was it easy? No, it was very, very difficult. But as I said, the support and my longtime lifetime friend, Helene and Jack Drown, yes. So thanks for the question.
Now, of course, we're in California, and President Nixon is from California. And La Casa Pacifica was known as the Western White House.
Right.
My husband, actually, grandparents used to live in San Clemente, and he said he used to see the Secret Service standing actually on the property overlooking the beach, because there was a train at the bottom, right, and then the beach, so they could see the Secret Service there, so they knew when you were there. And La Casa Pacifica is such a gorgeous home. I've been privileged to have been there time to get to see it. What made you fall in love with La Casa Pacifica to make it the Western White House?
I wanted to add one more thing to Watergate. Also, my husband and I are very, very religious people. You know, my husband was a Quaker, and Quakers are pacifists, and he didn't believe in fighting. And so when he brought the troops home from Vietnam, he was just such a great man. And we really trusted in God that this would work out. It was beyond us. And so we had tremendous, tremendous faith in leaving the White House. And then coming to Casa Pacifica, I think that the thing was, if you've ever lived near the water, It's just so peaceful, and Casa Pacifica is the peaceful house. So when we saw this house, it's not a very large house, but it's on a cliff overlooking the ocean.
Mm-hmm.
And oh my golly, I fell in love with it right away. I really did. There's a private beach. It's not big, but there's a private beach, and I love to walk. How many of you like to walk? Probably the whole room. So I love to walk, and Camp Pendleton really just actually ended where our beach, our tiny beach, belonged. So it was really great. It was a chance for me. Our daughter Julie had her first child very, very close by. So I could wear pants, I could hang out in my nightgown, if you will. I didn't have any really structured schedule, and it was absolutely wonderful. I loved it. When we came there, we left the White House with no money. We didn't have any money, and we had friends who were extremely supportive and helpful. And then my husband, who really cared a lot about, as you mentioned, getting involved in different activities. You know, he started the American Cancer Society.
Oh, yeah.
The EPA, getting women to elected, and he started so many things. And so he actually wrote 11 books, and he started writing, and then the sale of the book helped us to actually continue to pay for the Casa Pacifica. Anybody here been to Casa Pacifica? Oh my golly, wow. So you could tell us all about it and all about Ely and the it's a great group. This is a fantastic
group.
Well,
I wanted to mention something. You mentioned the draft, and my husband actually was in President Nixon ended the draft in August of, I believe it was 1973.
Mm-hmm.
And my husband was in the very first ROTC class for the all-volunteer force at Loyola Marymount University. So it's thanks to President Nixon that he was not drafted. He had a draft number, but because he has an amazing story about why he joined the military was because it was thanks to President Nixon. Now, just couple other questions before we end this conversation.
We had Elvis Presley come to the White House.
Oh,
how many of you know Elvis Presley? How many of you saw the movie? No, that's really it. Sorry, I digress.
Well, actually, it's something about the East Room, because
yeah.
Trisha's wedding was held in the Rose Garden.
Right.
But she had her reception in the East Room. Can you tell us a little bit about that reception in the East Room, her wedding?
Well, okay, in July, Trisha was married in July. And in July, what do you think the weather should be like in Washington, D.C.?
Hot,
right? Okay, so I get up on the morning that she was married, and I got up usually at 7:30 in the morning, and I opened the drapes in my room, and guess what? It's raining. It's raining. And so I thought, I'm just really tired, but I'm way too excited. And so if I pull the shades down and pull them up again, it's not going to be raining. I'm just hallucinating. I'm seeing things that I'm not supposed to be seeing. Well, by golly, it was raining. And we're talking rain, like here in Southern California for the last week. It was raining. So I get a knock on the door, and my wonderful staff, I had one person helping me, and she said, you know, Mrs. Nixon, you know it's raining. And I said, uh-huh. Can you please turn it off? We always had a great sense of humor. And she said, you know, the wedding is at 4:00 this afternoon, and what are we going to do? And I said, well, the first thing may I take your hand?
Of course.
Let's pray. Let's just pray again. Dear God, you know, if it's in your realm of having rain here, then it's going to rain. But if you can send an angel to turn off the rain, I think she was really, really fun in her prayer. And she said, you know, please, by 4:00 this afternoon, let's not have it rain. We had people coming in for the wedding, and we had umbrellas at the ready, and we had wonderful volunteers who were helping them. But all the way, I was thinking, it's raining. What are we going to do? How are we going to get the chairs in? So I couldn't go around with a dour face and said, oh my golly, it's raining. What are we going to do? We've come such a long way, but too bad. And, you know, we're going to have to do this and that and this and that. I just really tried to
like many of you, just tried to be in the moment and enjoy the people who had been coming. At 3:30, at 3 o'clock, I went upstairs to put on my dress that I was going to wear at the wedding, and I'm thinking the countdown is, we got from 3 o'clock until 4 o'clock to end this rain. So at 3:45, I lined up with my husband and Tricia and her husband, Ed, and I just said a quick prayer. I said, you know what? Because we left the seeds out, and they were all wiped out. They were all hopefully dry. At 3:45, guess what? It stopped raining. 4 o'clock, the wedding started. 4:25, the wedding ceremony ended. At 4:30, guess what? It started raining again. So it was like...
Thank you, God.
Thank you, God. Thank you very much. And that's a true story because... I was there, so I can tell you. Excuse me.
Now, you did so many things as First Lady. You started candlelight tours at the White House. You had the outside light put in. And I recall you flying in on a helicopter with President Nixon. And as he was landing, you had all the lights turned on outside the White House. What an accomplishment.
That was so much fun. You know, there are very few things, those of you who are married for quite a few years, there are very few things that a wife can surprise your husband. And one of the things that was so near and dear to his heart was the American flag. And so behind his back, I was able to orchestrate a committee that actually we were able to fly the flag. You know, you can fly the flag at night when a light is on it. And so we actually flew over the White House and what lights were lighting on the flag, and he was so excited. He really, how did you do this? And yeah, it was great. It was really great.
I'd like to ask you one more question, if you don't.
You've done so much research on this, and you have no notes or anything. Let's give Cindy an applause. This is really great. Yes.
When did you feel most proud to be First Lady of the United States? And what do you want people to remember you for doing?
Well, I have to take a beat here. There were so many things that we did with the help of so many people. I would probably say that the evening of the prisoners of war, I would have to say that was the evening that I was the most proud of my husband and our incredible staff. Well, let's take them out, and most proud of the prisoners of war.
Yeah.
Who had given their lives for this country. That probably was the most unforgettable and priceless event, and the most proud of my husband. What do I want people to remember about me? I think, you know, I would want them to know that even though I can't speak a lot of your languages, I would like you to know that every single person that I meet, I have love in my heart for them. That's what I'd like to remember. And also, without calling too much to myself, but all of the first ladies have code names. The Secret Service gave us all code names. And Jacqueline Kennedy's code name was Lace. I'm probably going to get this wrong, but they all had code names for something. And so the name that my Secret Service gave to me was Starlight. And I would like to live up to that name of being a really happy person who just loved my family, I loved my country, and I loved all of you for being here today. So if I had time, I would shake all of your hands and I'd give you a big hug and say thank you for all the wonderful work you're doing. Thank you for all the life-changing things that you're doing. And it's just been such an honor and a privilege for me to be here today. And God bless you all.
Thank you so much, Mrs. Nixon. This has been such a special time.
Thank you, Cindy.
And again, happy birthday.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I'm 111 years old. I think. Am I 101? Good job. You did such a great job. That's a lot to remember.